So looking at the different possible outcomes of interactions, let's first focus on mutual benefit or mutualism. The consequence of mutualism can be ecological, so that the presence of one species increases the abundance of another, and it can also be evolutionary. Both species will show adaptations that enhance their interactions with each other. These are two different species that really like each other, and they really want to be able to benefit from that interaction more effectively. So, classic case of mutualism is pollination. Pollinators, it turns out, are essential to the reproduction of flowering plants, whether they be bees, bats, or birds. The birds, bats, and bees receive pollen, which is a protein food source, and they also get nectar, which is a valuable source of carbohydrates. So the pollinators benefit from going to the flowers, and the plants require these pollinators. 90% of all flowering plants and a third of our crop plants depend on animal pollinators to produce fruit. The ecology of pollination is quite clear that fruit production is limited by pollen receipt in nearly two-thirds of flowering plants. The more pollen you receive from your pollinators, the more fruit you produce. And your fruit set increases with the number of different pollinator species you have. So plants really want to have pollinators, and they really benefit from it, and they pay for it by giving the pollinators protein and carbohydrates. Now, in terms of coevolution, we've seen in the past how specific the plant and the bee may interact with each other. So in this case, salvia has a particular place that it deposits its pollen on the bee. So the bee is receiving the pollen on a particular part of its body before it then transfers the pollen to yet another plant, thus fertilizing the seeds. Now, an amazing example of this comes from Madagascar, with the star orchid of Madagascar, which has this rather ugly name and something or other, sesquipedalia. Now, this has this enormous receptacle down here for nectar that fills up, okay? Very long. It's the longest of any plant in the world. And Darwin saw this and he said, well, you know, that can only be the case if there is a pollinator somewhere that has an extremely long tongue that can reach all the way down to the bottom of that tube to suck out the very last drop. Well, it wasn't until 1903 that somebody actually discovered a moth with, again, an unpronounceable name. But the last part, predicta, is an honor of Darwin's prediction that such a long-tongued pollinator would exist. So this very long tongue reaches inside that very long tube to get that very last drop of nectar out of the flower. So the point of this is that the pollinators do indeed evolve to track their flowers. There is coevolution between the two interacting species. Now, seed dispersal sometimes happens on its own. Seeds get blown to the wind. That happens with dandelions. We see those every spring and summer here in Minnesota. But a lot of plants encourage animals to swallow and hence disperse their seeds. And in Africa, we see a lot of examples of this with acacias. Acacias produce these seed pods that are kind of yummy. And a lot of animals, like elephants and impala, come up. They eat the seed pods of the plant. But then they wolf them down. So the elephant or the impala doesn't crush the seeds, and they come out the other end, okay? And it turns out that uneaten acacia seeds will not germinate unless you soak them in acid. They won't know that they're ready to go out and start a new plant unless they've actually been through a digestive system. So again, we have a benefit. The plant provides food. They eat the seed pods. We eat our apples. We eat oranges. We swallow the seeds and then we disperse them. So we do a favor for the plant, it does a favor for us. That's mutualism. That's the friendly face of evolution.